Dobrodošli na online bogosluženje za mlade. Moje ime je Ivan Popović i pastor sam Hrišćanske adventističke crkve. Verujem da i posle više od 2000 godina Biblija, iako drevna knjiga, ima šta da nam kaže o izazovima života danas. Kao i da nam predloži odgovore na velika životna pitanja. I zato svake subote popodne okupljamo različite osobe, formalno obrazovane u drugačijim oblastima, da nam iz svog iskustva govore o relevantnim izazovima sa kojima se suočavamo danas. Ovo je vreme za tebe. Cilj nam je da dosegneš ideale koji su duboko usađeni u tebe i da živiš život vredan življenja. Ukoliko ti se bude svidelo ono što vidiš, čuješ, možeš da se subscribe na ovaj kanal ili pak da lajkuješ ovaj video i podeliš ga sa drugima. U međuvremenu, zavali se da ti bude udobno, ali ne previše, i uživaj. Thank you.
Marley. Ona živi u Norveškoj, ali je studirala u Engleskoj na Newboldu, gdje je upoznala Viktora, koji je sada pastor i sa njim se venčala. Oni imaju troje dece. Radila je kao pastor u Norveškoj i Engleskoj, a sada je vođa omladinskog i porodičnog odjeljenja, kao i vođa izviđača u Norveškoj. Ona je vrlo kreativna i društvena osoba. Voli da se druži sa drugim ljudima, šeta, čita knjige. Ne zna da svira ni jedan instrument, ali uživa slušajući muziku. Krenula je u crkvu kada je imala 18 godina i tada je Bog postao neophodan deo njenog života.
1 Corinthians 13 ends with these words, and the greatest of these is love. I still remember that moment, as clearly as if it happened just yesterday, yet it was many years ago, sometime in the last century in actual fact, but I still remember how time stood still when I was first introduced to the young man who has since been such an important and huge part of my life. I remember feeling weak in my knees and butterflies in my stomach as his blue eyes looked into mine and he introduced himself. It was one of the few times in my life that has rendered me speechless. I think I only just managed to stutter out my own name before he was gone again. It took another 3 years before we really talked, and I realized that not only was he dashingly handsome, but he was funny, thoughtful, kind, intelligent, and best of all, he was a brilliant listener. When we started talking, we never stopped. It was like lightning striking twice over. We had instant chemistry and connection. It took us 4 months before we were engaged and another 6 months before we were married. I guess it's what is defined as a whirlwind romance. Sometimes when I tell someone this story, they get starry-eyed, they sigh and they say, "Oh, it's almost just like in the movies, like a typical rom-com movie where the main characters end up falling in love and living happily ever after." But then they ask the relevant question, why is it that this so rarely happens in reality? And my answer to that is because the true story is that relationships are difficult. Because they involve all of you. They involve your thoughts and your feelings. Sometimes it feels like there's only feelings and reason gets no place. Relationships make you vulnerable because it means giving of oneself. It means opening up to another person. There is a saying that says, no man is an island. We are social beings. We need each other. And people affect one another and nobody is perfect. And most people long to find the one they can spend the rest of their life with, their happily ever after, even if it isn't plain sailing. Solomon, one of the wisest men who ever lived, wrote about finding a virtuous and capable wife. In Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10 to 12, it says, "Who can find a virtuous and capable wife? She is more precious than rubies. Her husband can trust her, and she will greatly enrich his life. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life." And in what is known as a love chapter in the Bible, in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 to 7, it says, "Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, and is always hopeful and endures through every circumstance." Both of these descriptions of love and relationships by King Solomon and the Apostle Paul, they sound wonderful and something every human would want to experience. So then why is love so hard? Why are relationships difficult and at times painful? Marriages tend to start out on a high. Most relationships do. Most people who get married love each other at the point of marriage. Most people want to spend time together when they get married. So what happens along the way to make that love disappear? Many people say, we grew apart, or we have nothing in common anymore. We don't love each other anymore. And all these statements may be true, but why did the relationship end up in that situation? Was the choice wrong in the first place? For you, who are either in a relationship already, or you might be looking for a relationship and you want to make sure you choose the right person, there's a few things you need to remember. Firstly, the only person you can control and have any real influence over is yourself. You cannot control other people, only yourself. Therefore, it is essential that you make sure you get to know yourself. You need to understand where you come from, what is your family background like, what is your personality, what kind of baggage do you carry with you, how do you cope in stressful situations, how do you deal with conflict, how do you communicate, how do you express yourself, and how do you show love? And what are your expectations to a relationship? These are all very important questions that you need to ask yourself, and you need to try your utmost to be honest with yourself, and you need to recognize your own strengths and your own shortcomings. You need to get to know and to understand your personality, because only when you know, when you accept, and when you appreciate yourself, are you really able to commit in a healthy way to another person. And the second point is that you cannot always get it your way. You need at times to be willing to compromise. And at times you need to maybe just give in. Love is patient and kind, not jealous, boastful or proud. So if you both put each other's needs before your own, it will really strengthen your relationship. But the important factor here is that this is something both partners need to do. A relationship is a little bit like a seesaw. It needs to be balanced. So it means both parties have to be willing to give. The third point is that relationships are not a competition where one wins and another one loses. So you need to own your own feelings. Don't play the blame game and don't keep a score. Like Paul said, love keeps no record of wrongs. If one person in a relationship hurts, then it will also affect the other one. A relationship is in some way like a symbiosis. You depend on one another. The fourth point is that communication is key. Communication is more than just the words you say or write. Communication is also how you behave and look, the physical response you give. So you need to listen and to try to understand your partner. Don't be so focused on your response that you don't hear what the other person's saying. Love never gives up. It never loses faith. It is always hopeful and endures through every circumstance, Paul said. So take time to listen to the other person. And the fifth point is, last but not least, remember humor. It's important to be able to laugh together, to have fun together, to be able to relax and not take things too seriously all the time. Laughter makes for a happy home and a good marriage. And it also helps maintain your friendship. My relationship was maybe a whirlwind romance, but now, nearly 25 years later, we're still married. His blue eyes still make my stomach flutter. He still makes me laugh and he still takes time to talk with me. But we have put a lot of work into our relationship along the way. And I believe there are a few things that have been a key to our success so far. Those are things like the fact that we respect each other. We value each other. And we also say thank you to each other on a daily basis. We thank each other when the other one does something, whether it's being something very basic, like doing the dishes or cooking dinner or mowing the lawn, anything that contributes to the family life. There's even times we just thank each other for being who we are. You have to remember that marriage is a leap of faith. You make a choice to trust another person so much that you want to share your life with him or her. Things you have to consider before choosing who to marry is to make sure you feel safe with that person and to make sure they respect you and value you. And also, make sure you share core values in life, that you share what is most important to you. And as time goes by, remember that love is not just a feeling, it's also a decision. Like King Solomon said in the text in Proverbs that I read, relationships is about trust and it's about enriching one another's life. You should get even better together. We should bring each other good and not harm all the days of our life. Because there will come difficult times. All relationships have their ups and their downs. And when times get hard, don't be scared to seek help together. Because sometimes an outside perspective is good and healthy. So to sum up the 5 points I made with regards to relationships, they are as follows. Firstly, love and know yourself. Only then can you truly give of yourself to another person. 2. Don't be stubborn. At times you need to give in or just let it pass. 3. It's not about winning. It's about sharing. 4. Listen and then talk. 5. Have fun. Lastly, remember when you find the one you decide to marry, then choose every day to continue to love and appreciate your partner. Choose to focus on the good, on their strengths, and never forget the love of your youth, what brought you together in the first place, what attracted you to each other, the initial love that you shared. And if one day you do get married, or you are married already, or maybe you're just in a relationship, then make sure you thank God for your spouse, your partner, and pray for them every single day. A blessed marriage is a lasting marriage. And if you're still single, but you are hoping that one day you might find the one, then use this time to really get to know and understand yourself and thank God for making you you. And for all of you, be thankful to God for the ability to be someone for other people. And thank God for the ability to love and to share your life with others. Remember, 3 things will last forever. Faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love.
So if you've heard of Jesus, you probably know about one of his famous teachings called the Golden Rule. Do to others what you would want them to do to you. And this, actually, is a restatement of something else that Jesus said, that the meaning of life is to love God and love your neighbor as yourself. Now, that's really beautiful, but what does he mean exactly by the word love? It's an unclear word in English, because you can love your mom and you can love pizza. And if the word love means the same thing in both of those cases, your mom's gonna feel real bad. So what did Jesus mean in his language? Well, first of all, this love your neighbor phrase is a quotation from the Hebrew scriptures, where the word for love is ahava. However, the language Jesus spoke and taught in from day to day, it was a cousin language of Hebrew, that is Aramaic, in which the word for love is rachma. But then, as Jesus' followers spread his teachings around the world, they translated them into Greek, using the word agape. But here's what's fascinating. The earliest followers of Jesus, who wrote the books of the New Testament in Greek, they didn't learn the meaning of agape by looking it up in ancient dictionaries. Rather, they looked to the teachings of Jesus and the story of his life to redefine their very concept of love. So one time, Jesus was asked about the most important command in the Jewish scriptures. And he first quoted from the ancient prayer in the Torah called the Shema, "Love the Lord your God with all of your heart." So love for God is the most important thing. But then Jesus quickly followed up by saying another command from the Torah was also the most important, to love your neighbor as yourself. So which is the most important, loving God or loving your neighbor? Jesus' answer is yes. To ask the question means you don't get his point. For Jesus, they are 2 sides of the same coin. Your love for God will be expressed by your love for people, and vice versa, they're inseparable. And so this makes it clear that for Jesus, agape love is not primarily a feeling for someone else that happens to you, like our phrase, I fell in love. For Jesus, love is action. It's a choice that you make to seek the well-being of people other than yourself. Jesus also went on to teach that genuine love for God and others means seeking people's well-being without expecting anything in return, especially from people who are in difficult situations, who can't repay you even if they wanted to. According to Jesus, this kind of generous love reflects the very heartbeat of God. And he took this even further. Jesus said that the ultimate standard of authentic love is how well you treat the person that you can't stand. Or in his words, you shall love your enemy and do good to them, expecting nothing in return. For Jesus, this kind of enemy-embracing love imitates the very character of God himself. Now, we wouldn't be talking about Jesus still today if he had only said things like love your enemy. This is how he actually lived. Jesus was constantly helping and serving the people around him in very practical and tangible ways. And he consistently moved towards poor and hurting people who couldn't benefit him in return. He showed love for the forgotten ones, the people who usually fall through the cracks. And when Jesus eventually marched into Jerusalem, he made himself an enemy of the leaders of his people by accusing them of hypocrisy and corruption. But then instead of attacking his enemies to overthrow them, he allowed them to kill him. Jesus died for the selfishness and corruption of his enemies because he loved them. After Easter morning, Jesus and then his followers claimed that it was the power of God's love for the world that was revealed in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. As the Apostle Paul put it, God demonstrated his own agape for us in this: while we were still sinners, the Messiah died for us. Or in the words of the Apostle John, God's own agape was revealed when he sent his one and only Son into the world so that through him we could have life. And for John, then, this leads naturally to the conclusion, beloved ones, if that's how God has loved us, then we ought to show love for one another. So Christian faith involves trusting that at the center of the universe is a being overflowing with love for his world, which means that the purpose of human existence is to receive this love that has come to us in Jesus and then to give it back out to others, creating an ecosystem of others-focused, self-giving love. And that's the New Testament meaning of agape love.
Marica Mirilov je rođena u Starom Slatiniku u Hrvatskoj 1966. godine u jednoj katoličkoj porodici. 81. godine donela odluku da se krsti i tako postala prvi adventista u svojoj porodici. Pohađala je srednju adventističku školu u Maruševcu gde je upoznala svog supruga Branislava. Oni su se venčali 85. godine i odlučili da nastave školovanje u Engleskoj. Marica uživa u pisanju hrišćanske proze i svoje delo Ples na rubu objavila je 2015. godine. Ona je radila na Newbald College-u, 5 godina je sa svojim suprugom služila u Stuttgartu, a u prelepoj Moskvi radila je kao profesor engleskog jezika, dok je Branislav bio potpredsjednik Euroazijske divizije Adventističke crkve. Od 2012. godine oni služe u Nikoziji, Marica kao biblijska radnica odgovorna za rad dečjeg odjeljenja, rad sa izviđačima, službu žena i porodicu, dok je Branislav predsjednik Kiparske regije Adventističke crkve.
Evo nas na savršenoj destinaciji za medeni mesec. Kipar je poznat kao ostrvo ljubavi i kao rodno mesto boginje lepote i ljubavi Afrodite. Iza mene vidite stenu Petru Turomiju, za koju se veruje po grčkoj mitologiji da je pravo njeno rodno mesto. Kipar, po njegovom lepom okruženju, je savršeno mesto gdje da provedite svoje prve dane sa novim supružnikom, u miru i spokoju, u društvu jedno drugog. Ja sam Marica Mirilov i moj ceo život sam posvetila pomaganju ljudima da nađu puninu i lepotu života. Prošle godine napisala sam Branislavovu i moju ljubavnu priču, koja opisuje 2 godine našeg zabavljanja, koje nas je dovelo do braka koji već traje 35 godina. Moja teorija ljubavi je ovo: čovjek voli svojim karakterom. A danas ćemo se fokusirati na dva veoma važna pitanja. Prvo pitanje: šta je to što mi unosimo u našu prvu bračnu noć. A drugo pitanje povezano s tim, kako da živimo život? A naročito u to hormonalno turbulentnoj fazi. Da stvorimo jednu zdravu osnovu za dugotrajni ili doživotnu ljubav.
Što je to što unosimo u našu prvu bračnu noć? Zajedno sa spakovanim koferom, sa najlepšom pidžamom i spavačicom, potrebnom zaštitom i sličnom, htjeli mi to ili ne, s nama u našu prvu bračnu noć ulazi nepoželjan prtljak. Zlostavljanje je prisutno svugdje i u raznim oblicima. Fizičko, mentalno i emotivno, seksualno zlostavljanje, gdje se zlostavljenom ukrade ono što je najdragocenije. Uz Božju i profesionalnu pomoć potrebno je popraviti što se da popraviti, povratiti što se može povratiti, čovječje dostojanstvo, poverenje, a ono najvažnije da ima sposobnost da ponovo voli. Jedan razgovor me je duboko uverio da je o ovoj temi itekako potrebno otvoreno i ozbiljno razgovarati. Johnny i Clea spremali su se za njihovu svadbu, zamolili su pastora Branislava, iako nisu bili članovi crkve, da se pomoli u toku njihove svadbene večere, pošto nije bilo crkvenog vjenčanja, a to je Johnny bio drugi brak. Branislav je pristao pod jednim uslovom da se malo bolje upoznamo pre svadbe i tako poslije prvog razgovora zamolio nas je da nasamo s njime porazgovaramo. John kao tinejdžer bio je seksualno zlostavljen. Kada je o tome porazgovarao sa roditeljima, roditelji su odmah konfrontirali zlostavljača i utvrdilo se da nije samo zlostavljao Johnnya, nego i drugu decu. Prije nego što mu je bilo presuđeno, on si je sam presudio štrikom oko vrata. Ceo njegov život Johnny je nosio teret ne samo zlostavljanja, nego na duši je nosio smrt njegovog zlostavljača. Pastore, ovo je uništilo moj prvi brak. Nikad nisam imao smelosti da porazgovaram otvoreno ovo mom teretu sa mojom bivšom suprugom, a niti sa devojkom koju sada ženim. Da li je moguće da me Bog očisti i uzme taj težak teret od mene? Usrdno smo se pomolili sa Johnom i molimo se za Johna, ali smo ga posavjetovali da potraži ne samo Božju pomoć, nego i profesionalnu pomoć, a kada se ukaže najbolja prilika i u dobro vrijeme da to taj tajni dio svog života podeli sa novom suprugom. Bogu je moguće i On to želi očistiti i zlostavljenog i zlostavljača od ovog teškog tereta. Potražite profesionalnu pomoć, uz Božju pomoć. Ako ste se ikad našli u jednoj ili u drugoj ulozi, sa Bogom je moguće osloboditi se ovog strašnog grijeha. U našu prvu bračnu noć unosimo i naše financijske dugove. Mnogi su opterećeni sa studijskim dugovima, obavezama prema prvom braku, možda lošim investicijama, drugim dugovima. Pre naše svadbe, moj vjerenik mi je rekao da ima neke dugove, ali tek posle svadbe mi je tačno rekao kako visokoj svoti novca se radi. Bila sam duboko povređena i razočarana. Mislila sam da se svi pravilno odnose prema novcu. Ana i Ron potražili su pomoć i ustanovili se da Ron ima nekontrolisanu potrebu za trošenjem novca. Njihova financijska situacija se stabilizirala i oni su sretni što mogu uživati jednom zdravom braku. U našu prvu bračnu noć unosimo i sve naše ovisnosti, lažno rješenje i želja da se ispuni praznina koju osjećamo u našem životu. Moj muž mi kaže da me voli, a znam dugo u noć u drugoj sobi sedi opsednut pornografijom, a ja se osjećam neadekvatnom, neatraktivnom i definitivno osjećam se usamljenom u braku. Ako imate ovisnosti, tražite pomoć, jer kuća vašeg karaktera erodira i to sam temelj. U našu prvu bračnu noć unosimo i sve naše prijašnje odnose. Mnogi nose duboke rane koje nose iz prijašnjeg braka, probnog braka ili zabavljanja bez granica. Marica, ja nisam sigurna da li ja imam uopšte pravo da se udam za jednog normalnog mladića. Zbog čestog menjanja partnera u periodu kada sam bila studentkinja, zaradila sam seksualno prenosivu bolest i nisam sigurna da li uopšte mogu da imam decu. Sandy se usadno borila sa njenim fizičkim problemom, ali isto tako emotivnim problemom zbog neodgovornosti prema samoj sebi i njenom budućem supružniku. Provodili smo sate u proučavanju Biblije, u molitvama, gdje je Sandy usadno tražila od Boga da joj pomogne i da joj da novu šansu za normalan život. Ona se sretno udala za rastavljenog čovjeka i imaju dvoje zdrave dece. Ona nas dovodi našem drugom pitanju. Kako živjeti svoj život, čak i kroz hormonalno najturbulentniju fazu svog života, kako biste stvorili zdravu osnovu za doživotnu ljubavnu vezu? Jedan savjet od teta Marice. U vašu prvu bračnu noć unesite poklon neprocjenjive vrednosti koji samo vi možete uneti. A to je vaša nevinost, devičanstvo ili čednost. Neki ćete kazati, pa zakasnili ste sa savjetom. A ja mislim, ne. Nevinost ili čednost nije samo fizičko stanje. To je moralna odluka i to je duhovno stanje čovjeka. Ako ste u prošlosti pravili greške, možete sebi oprostiti, možete potražiti Božje oproštenje i uz njegovu pomoć započeti od početka. Neki to nazivaju izbor sekundarne nevinosti. Velik broj mladih se u stvari odlučuje na ovaj izbor. Želim pročitati par citata od uglednih psihologa i savjetnika. Evo prvi šta kaže. Odluka da poklonite vašem supružniku vašu nevinost ili sekundarnu nevinost kao poklon za prvu bračnu noć pomoći će vam da izgradite dobar karakter i vodite osmišljen i srećan zajednički život. Jedan drugi kaže, ova odluka pokazuje zrelo razmišljanje osobe koja želi da kontroliše svoje želje. Ako nekoga upoznajete ili ste u vezi, zapamtite, ako je ljubav, prava ljubav čeka. Šta je sa mentalnim, emotivnim i duhovnim posljedicama predbračnih seksualnih veza? Seks uključuje našu celokupnu osobu, ne samo fizički aspekt. Ne varajte se, ne postoji kondom za srce, um ili dušu. I još jedan citat, čuvajući vašu nevinost za brak, čekanje razvija sljedeće vrline: vernost, samokontrolu, skromnost, dobro prosuđivanje, hrabrost, iskreno poštovanje sebe i drugih. Razvijajte takav karakter koji će vas učiniti dobrim bračnim drugom i privući osobu s kojom želite provesti vaš ceo život. Danas je dan odluke. Imate dva izbora. Prvi. Danas se možete odlučiti na žaljenje i samooptuživanje, bojazan od neželjene trudnoće ili seksualno prenosivih bolesti i sve kao posljedica toga što menja vaš život u negativnom pravcu. Da nosite osjećaj krivice, osjećaj iskorištavanosti ili osjećaj da iskorištavate nekog drugog, unižen nivo samopoštovanja. Jedna srušena moralna granica će vas voditi rušenju drugih. Razvijanje gneva u vezi bez obaveza, koji ponekad dovodi do nasilja, depresija koja ponekad dovodi do samoubistva, strah od raspada veze jer seks često dominira u vezi, prepreka za razvitak vaše celokupne ličnosti jer prerani seks može da ometa vaš razvoj identiteta. Kao posljedica, bračni stres koji nastaje zbog neplodnosti izazvane spolno prenosivom bolešću i borba grehom koji vas odvaja od Boga i ne dopušta iskrenu prisnost sa Bogom. Evo, to je prvi izbor. A drugi izbor, da se čuvate za vašu prvu bračnu noć. Razvijajte zdravu vezu time što si dajete priliku da se upoznate na svim nivoima. Kada je vaša veza seksualno bazirana, to postaje predominantni način vezivanja. Strada duhovni, emocionalni, intelektualni razvitak u toj vezi. Pomoći će vam da pronađete pravog partnera, nekog ko će vas ceniti zbog vas sami, ne kao predmeta njegovog seksualnog zadovoljavanja. Čekanje će povećati vaše samopoštovanje. Čekanjem ćete se zadobiti poštovanje drugih. Ima puno više mladih koji se odlučuju na čekanje nego što vam se predstavlja kroz mediju. Čekanje vas uči da poštujete druge. Nećete stavljati pritisak na drugu osobu. Čekanje vas oslobađa samo pritiska. Čekanje znači imati čistu savjest, bez krivice i duševni mir, bez sukoba, bez žaljenja. Čekanje znači zagarantirano bolji seksualni odnos u braku, bez upoređivanja sa drugim predbračnim partnerima i zasnovan na poverenju. I na kraju, čekajući, vi ste vjerni supružniku i pre nego što ga upoznate. Ne zaboravite, osoba voli svojim karakterom.
Evo nas na istom mjestu gdje smo i započeli našu prezentaciju danas. Želim zaključiti sa duboko poučnim biblijskim tekstom koji se nalazi u knjizi Rimljanima, 12. poglavlju, stihovi 9 i 10. Ljubav da ne bude lažna. Mrzeći na zlo, držite se dobra. Posvećenom ljubavi, budite jedan drugome ljubazni. Čašću jedan drugoga većeg činite.
Nadam se da je bogosluženje danas bilo korisno. Možeš da pregledaš i ostali da pristupiš sličnom sadržaju kada se subscribe na naš kanal. Ako ste uživali dok ste slušali i naučili nešto što je vredno isprobati i živjeti, možete da lajkujete ovaj video, ali i da ga podelite sa svojim prijateljima, kolegama i poznanicima. Ukoliko želite da saznate nešto više u našoj crkvi, možete da posjetite zvaničnu internet stranicu www.adventisti.net i Facebook i Instagram profile Mladi JIEU. Nadam se da je ovo vreme sa nama danas pomoglo određenim izazovima i da te pokrenulo da živiš bolje nego ikada pre.